How to be religious without losing your soul is my message this morning. And I'm going to be reading from the last directive in the book of Joshua that Joshua gives to the people of God to challenge them and encourage them and warn them about how to be people of faith that live out good and healthy religious faith without becoming dry and stale and petty in their religious faith. Because you see, most human beings on the planet are religious, and there is some religious practices and habits that are good for our soul and some that are not. And most of us, we have a drift in our lives. And there's this, there was the Moses generation that experienced the people of God being liberated out of Egypt. And they knew very well what it meant to depend on God for everything. God was the source of their bread. God was their source of their water. God was their source of their very lives. God was the source of their freedom. And then in the Joshua generation, there's this very clear sense of opposition and needing to take hold of that which has already been won, to take possession of the victory that has already been won for the people of God. And so they were warring, they were striving, they were taking possession, they were pushing forward. And sometimes in life, I don't know about you, but when you're pushing forward, when you're striving, when you know what you're enemy is, or you know what your target is, or you know what your opposition is, and when you're pushing against that opposition, you actually make progress and you have direction in your life. And time again, I see people in this country and in our even in our church, people that have had to go through incredible opposition and incredible hard times, and they overcome the opposition, they overcome the hard times, and I see at the end of it a person of character, a person of strength, and a person of joy. And time I see people overcome and people go through things and people go through incredible adversity, and then they come to a place of provision, they come to a place of inheritance, they come to a place of safety, and they lose their direction because they become obsessed with self, or they become, or their hearts drift towards the easy things. Their hearts drift towards self-sufficiency rather than God-sufficiency and God-trust and clinging to the Lord. I was talking to a man from Iraq, and he said the biggest challenge for him and some of the people that he ministers to, he said bringing up children in Iraq to follow Jesus is not as difficult as bringing up children to follow Jesus in Australia. He said over there, it's Jesus, there's life, death, and there's Jesus. He said here, man, my kids, they've got social media, they've got distractions at school, they've got all these things that are crowding on their life, and there's no pressure. And how many people know that it takes pressure to produce diamonds? Well, I want us to not just be a Joshua generation that takes ground. You know, some people would say that we're a healthy, we're a good church. We're not a perfect church, but we're a healthy, we're a good church. And we have received an inheritance. Look around this building. Look at all the Christian Family Center churches. But let's not be the generation that is not the Joshua generation, but the generation that we read in the book after the book of Joshua, which is in the book of Judges, that time and time again trust in themselves and drift away from God and only call out to God when we're desperate. And so rather than hungering and thirsting for his presence, rather than hungering and thirsting for his next step to overcome, rather than hungering and thirst to know him as our, not just the one that sets us free from physical slavery, but spiritual slavery over and over again, not just being our savior, but being our savior every day of our lives. Why don't you stand to your feet as we read the word of God from Joshua 24 verse 14. Joshua, this is his directive to the people of God. Just before, it says that he was very old and he wanted to go out with a cracking sermon. So this is what he did. Now fear the Lord and serve him with all faithfulness. Throw away the gods your ancestors worshipped beyond the Euphrates River and in Egypt, and serve the Lord. But if serving the Lord seems undesirable to you, then choose for yourselves this day whom you will serve, whether the gods of your ancestors served beyond the Euphrates or the gods of the Amorites in those whose land you are living. But as for me and my household, we will serve the Lord. Then the people answered, far be it for us to forsake the Lord to serve other gods. It was the Lord our God himself who brought us and our parents up out of Egypt from that land of slavery and produced these great signs before our eyes. He protected us on our entire journey and among the nations through which we traveled. And the Lord drove out all the nations, including the Amorites who lived in this land. We too will serve the Lord because he is our God. Joshua said to the people, you are not able to serve the Lord. He is a holy God. He is a jealous God. He will not forgive your rebellion and your sins. If you forsake the Lord and serve foreign gods, he will turn and bring disaster on you and make an end of you after he has been good to you. But the people said to Joshua, no, we will serve the Lord. Then Joshua said, you are witnesses against yourself that you have chosen to serve the Lord. Yes, we are witnesses, they replied. Now then, said Joshua, throw away the foreign gods that are among you and yield your hearts to the Lord, the God of Israel. And the people said to Joshua, we will serve the Lord, our God, and obey him. On that day, Joshua made a covenant for the people. And there at Shechem, he reaffirmed to them the decrees and the laws. And Joshua recorded these things in the book of the law of God. Then he took a large stone and set it up under the oak near the holy place of the Lord. See, he said to all the people, this stone will be a witness against us. It has heard all the words the Lord has said to us, and it will be a witness against you if you are untrue to your God. Then Joshua dismissed the people, each to their own inheritance. This is the word of the Lord. Let's take our seats. The people were dismissed, each to their own inheritance. They were inheritant that they inherited that which would had been won through blood, sweat, and tears and faith, often from their parents and grandparents. It's so easy for movements of faith to become monuments of history or museums that remind us of what happened in a movement. The Joshua generation took hold of the land that was given them by God, and the generation that followed was not shaped emotionally by the stories of the Exodus. Oh, they could recount the stories of the Exodus. They could talk about the miracles, but they were not emotionally shaped by the transformative power of being at death's door and then being saved. And they were not shaped by the great journey for a homeland. You see, when the people were journeying for a homeland, they were shaped by the hunger, but also the ecstasy of finding their new home. I see this in people that I meet in our own church, in our community, from refugee backgrounds. And I see the hunger to be part of this community. I see the hunger to say, I am so thankful that God has given me a land of safety where I can bring up my family in peace and harmony in this country. Some of the most outstanding and thankful people I meet and I've met, including in this church, are people that have lived for many years in refugee camps, that have a lot to be unthankful for. But the next generation that doesn't have that hunger and that thankfulness, often the Joshua generation can turn into the Judges generation. And this message is a message to the generation by Joshua that the people of God will pass on what they have learned, that will pass on something of their faith to the next generation, but it didn't work. Parents try to pass on behaviors and principles to their children, but parenting is so much more than that. If there was a computer program to instill behaviors into my child, I would have bought it by now. The thing that really communicates and passes over from cultures and from generation to generation is not behaviors and not just arbitrary principles, but it's culture and it's values. I've seen many different types of parenting in the church. I've seen the helicopter Christian parents. They try to hover over their kids and make sure that they know everything their kids are doing. That doesn't work always. I've seen the school teacher Christian parent that try to teach their kids everything that there is to know about the world and about the Bible, and they discipline their kids. They are like the school teacher parent, and I mean, that doesn't always work. I've seen the postmodern Christian parent that I'm going to teach my child to doubt everything. I'm going to teach them to doubt authority. I'm going to teach them to doubt their teachers. I'm going to teach them to doubt the preacher. I'm going to teach them to doubt everything. And then in the end, I trust that the Holy Spirit will lead them back. Well, that doesn't always work. I've seen the chilled out Christian parent. That's the Christian parent I wanted. Just the relaxed and just let you do what you want and just they're happy no matter what. Well, that doesn't always work. I've seen the family first Christian parent, that it's all about the family and it's all about family every weekend and every holiday, and it's all about, it's kind of like, well, it might not be homeschooling, and nothing wrong with homeschooling, but it's like everything's about the family and we're going to keep everyone nice and close so we don't let the kids too far out of our reach. And that doesn't always work either. You know what I think works in terms of transmitting culture and values to the next generation? And that goes for us as a church. I think it's a very powerful word, and it's called influence. Because we cannot change the heart of the person sitting next to us in this room. We cannot change the hearts of our children. We cannot, no matter what an amazing father I am, I cannot control what my daughter will do with her life. But I can influence. I've just been researching this word influence. Influere, from derived from Latin, and it means into the flow. Into the flow. And I just had this picture of, imagine there's this great crowd of people moving in a direction, and you're on the outside of the crowd, and you've got a child behind you. And that child cannot break into the stream of people. But me, because I'm such a massive unit and I work out heaps, I can break into that flow of people. Break into the flow. I don't know why you're laughing. I break into the flow and I create a path for my child to enter into the flow behind me. That is influence. I am not forcing my child. I am not throwing my child in there. I am not preaching to my child, get in there, hurry up, what are you doing? I am influencing by leadership, by sacrificial leadership. I am creating a path that others can be into the flow as I am caught up into the flow of God's Holy Spirit. You become not what you tell other people to do. You don't become what other people tell you to become. You become what you love. Once again, I love coffee. My daughter is obsessed with drinking coffee at the moment. She's 6. So I make her these big milk drinks and I put a little coffee in the top, and then she's like, Mom, Dad gives me coffee. Yeah. And she's obsessed with coffee. And then if I tell her, Amari, I want you to watch this movie. I want you to watch this. Come on, watch this. And she looks at it and she's like, that looks boring. That's like from the 1980s. Put it away. But if I tell her the story that, Amari, this was my favorite movie when I was a little boy your age, her eyes flare and she goes, really? And then she watches it and then she says, I watched the movie that used to be my daddy's favorite when he was a little boy. Because there's something about influencing people with what you love that transmits generation to generation. And if we just become a church of do's and don'ts and behavioral management, we will never influence and impart the value of Jesus being worthy of our everything and the most worthy being to love in the planet. We won't transmit that to the next generation. I want to talk about 5 shifts from this passage that we need to take to really pass on true, alive religion and faith, not dead religion, to the next generation. And maybe for our own lives, there's 5 shifts that we have to make to awaken a vibrant, growing faith and not a dead, stale faith that we can pass on to the next generation. The first shift is this. We need to shift from just focusing on loving God to fearing and serving Him faithfully. Hang on. Love God, that's pretty safe, you know. I mean, love God and love people, isn't that what we're called to do? Absolutely, absolutely. You see, when I was in Sydney for Christmas, I was watching The Big Bash one night, which pretty much I did every night. That's what we call holidays. And I was, I know, can I hear an amen? Did anyone else watch way too much cricket? Yeah, okay. And anyway, I was lying on the couch with my hands back behind my head, and I was just lying out, and I was just completely relaxed. But as a man, you're quite vulnerable to attack when you're completely relaxed with the hands behind the head. Does everyone know what I mean? Yep. I was lying there, and my brother, my punk brother, who's 7 years younger than me, he grabbed like some sort of ball or ornament from the dinner table that was behind. He was playing cards, and he just said to everyone, watch this. And he threw it. It was really heavy as well. And he threw it, and he got me right where it hurts. And he thought it was hilarious, and I was in pain. And I knew that it was funny because everyone went, you know, the room went quiet. Not because out of respect, but it went quiet because they were all laughing and they couldn't breathe because it was so funny. And I'm on the floor and it's just quiet. And then I heard the, like the funny laughs. Anyway, and then my brother, he goes, love you, Tim. Love you, brother. As if that will make me not want to seek revenge. Luckily, I'm not big on, I'm not one of those revenge people. So that's why I'm a target. I'm a lover, not a fighter. But he goes, love you, brother. And I'm thinking, mate, you don't love me. You just hurt me in a way that no brother should hurt another brother. And then I was listening to him. He's been married about 3 years now, and he just, he said something pretty harsh to his wife. It was just banter, mucking around, and I thought, man, if I said that, I'd be in big trouble. And he said something really cheeky to his wife, and then he just goes, love you. Whatever he says, if he's cheeky, if he's rude, he goes, love you. And I felt like saying to his wife, he doesn't love you. Why does he keep on saying those things? Don't let him get away with the I love you clause. If I was to ask you, do you love Jesus? Do you love God? Most people would say that, yes. Even most non-Christians would say that they have love or respect for Jesus. The question is not, do you love God? But does your love manifest in awe and in reverence and a healthy fear of the Lord? And does it manifest in serving him faithfully? This is what the passage says, verse 14. Now fear the Lord and serve him with all faithfulness. So this is what relationship with God looks like. It looks like not being scared of God so you run away from him, but being in so awe and reverence towards him and being in fear of what life would look like apart from him, that you are drawn to him in surrender and worship. So fear the Lord and serve him with all unfaithfulness. Throw away your old worship of the old gods. And then it says, but if serving the Lord seems undesirable to you, then choose for yourselves this day whom you will serve. There has to be a choice to serve. If you're here, if you're a religious person, if you're a person that's a person of faith, I want to tell you the question is not do you love God, but who do you serve? Because I believe that it's pretty hard to hate Jesus, or at least to say that you hate Jesus, but you might say that you love Jesus, but who have you chosen to serve? It's impossible to love someone without serving them. It is possible to serve someone without loving them. I just really felt compelled just to talk to all the carers in the room. Nurses, carers, people that are on the front lines of giving care to people. You know, you guys are doing some of the most important work and ministry in the kingdom of God. Never forget that you can serve people without loving them, or you can serve people and love them while you serve them. In our lives, there's people that you might say, I love you, but you don't really love them. You're taking advantage of their goodness. Who today will you serve? Who are you serving above all else? And it's not serving to win God's favor. It's because of his great love, we love him in return. And that love looks like faithful service, devotion, and fear of the Lord. Don't just assume because you're at church, you truly love God and serve him fully. Joshua said this, choose for yourself this day whom you will serve. My question is this, Who are you serving in your life? It might be yourself. It might be your family. Are you serving God above all else? Second shift is the shift from my personal faith to me and my household. I think we, as Christians in the West, have personalized faith so much that it's all about me and my relationship with God, but God actually wants you to express your discipleship in the context of community. In verse 15, Joshua says, hey, you need to choose who you will serve, but as for me and my household, we will serve the Lord. In ancient Israel, a household wasn't just your biological family. It could include extended family. It could include people traveling, sojourners, people that are visiting the home. It could include refugees. It could include orphans. Because back then they didn't have Medicare and they didn't have structured social support networks. So the basic community was the family, but the household was biological family, but also bigger than that. As for me and my household, we will serve the Lord. This is where influence comes in. You see, your responsibility, who are you responsible for? You are not responsible for everyone in the world, but you are responsible to follow God in the context of your household. You are called to influence others towards the worship of the God of Israel, the God of the Christians, God, the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. You are called to worship Him in the context of your household. It does not mean you can control your household. It does not mean that you can manage everyone in your household, but you can lead and you can influence your household. And you can say, we will worship the Lord. In generations gone past, I know that many Christian leaders, ministers of the gospel, missionaries, have served God on the mission field or served God in the church 6-7 days a week, and their families have suffered, their biological families have suffered, and their children have grown up to resent the church. I'm noticing a shift in the kingdom of God of younger leaders saying, we will not forsake the discipleship of our own family for the sake of the kingdom of God, because our family is part of the kingdom of God. You see, it doesn't have to be either or. In Matthew 6:33, it says to seek first the kingdom of God and His righteousness. Let me tell you, you are not seeking first the kingdom of God if you forsake the people that God has planted around your life for you to be most influential to. Now, what is wrong is if you allow your biological family to control your ministry, to control your priorities. Some people, it's like their kingdom, their world is their family. And I think that can be sin. Because do you know what I believe? I believe God wants to expand your family. Now, I don't mean you have to go out and start having more kids, although some of you might want to do that. Good luck. But I believe that God wants to expand your household to your next door neighbors. And once a week, He might want to invite, you might want to start inviting that next door neighbor into your house and say, come and be part of our home. And you can seek to influence that person towards the King. I think for some of us, we have a large proportion of this church are people that are single. Wouldn't it be great if more families and more couples could open up their home to people that are not living in a nuclear family and say, hey, we want to extend our family so that our whole household is not insular, but we are giving and generous. Are you with me? The room's gone real quiet. I wonder if God actually might not want to destroy your household. He might want to expand it. I wonder if God might want to do something in your life so you have a heart for the kingdom that inspires your household to be generous rather than insular. I wonder if the greatest gift you can give to your kids or your siblings is to be a generous person to others and to not worship your family, but to love them and esteem them, but to not put them first, to put God first. Let's not forsake our family, but let's not worship our family. My personal faith to me and my household. Jesus loved children. I'm sure He would want us to be good and godly parents, but He also warned His disciples very clearly against choosing family over the path of a disciple. So my second question is this. Who is your household? Who are the people that God has placed in your life to influence? And it doesn't mean that that's your whole world. It doesn't mean that you only spend time with those people. But God has given you a sphere of influence. It might be 10 people, it might be 15 people, and you are uniquely placed to influence them. Who is your household and how will you help them to serve the Lord? Number three, the third shift is confidence in our ability to achieve, shifting to confidence in our tendency to self-deceive. It's quite morbid, but I like it. Amari and I were I was trying to teach Amari how to ride a bike yesterday with not much success. And so we made ourselves into a little team and we called ourselves Team Winning. And we made a special handshake and all this stuff. And we go, 1, 2, 3, Team Winning. And it wasn't very original, but I thought it was inspiring. And I thought, you know, I'll give her some self-confidence, self-belief. But I think sometimes we have too much confidence in our ability to do life well. It's a new year. I'm gonna make good choices this year. It's a new year. I'm gonna love God and I'm gonna read my Bible and I'm gonna seek the Lord and I'm gonna have healthy relationships and I'm not gonna be jealous and I'm not gonna be distracted and I'm not gonna be petty. I think we need to have less confidence in our ability to achieve in our own strength. And we need to be assured that we have a tendency to self-deceive and to drift away from God. And the only answer is to have confidence in God and His sufficiency to help us bring order and purpose in our lives. And so rather than having confidence in our own ability, we have to have confidence in Him. And because we are pessimistic about our own ability, we cling to Him even tighter. That is what we need more and more. Because if you're banking on leaving a legacy to the next generation, the next generation won't necessarily care about your achievements or your holiday house or your money. I believe the greatest legacy you can leave to the next generation is your dependence upon Christ. In the text it says this, verse 16, far be it for us to forsake the Lord and serve other gods. So the people of God said, we're not going to serve the other gods. We're going to serve the God of Israel because He's done all these amazing things for us. And then Joshua says, you are not able to serve the Lord. It's like He just gives them the truth pill. And He just says, I'm going to tell you the truth. You say you're going to serve God. You say you're going to worship Him. You say you're going to forsake the other gods, but I'm going to tell you the truth. You are not able to serve the Lord. Sometimes that's the purpose of the gospel. We needed Jesus. We needed someone to set us free from our sin and our shame and our pride and our self-sufficiency and our self-love and to set us free to love the God that has given His all for us. We needed a Savior. We could not fulfill all the requirements of the law, and so Jesus was required. And so when we hear these challenges of Scripture, the first point is saying, I can't do this without God saving and redeeming and transforming my life and His Spirit leading me and guiding me. That's the purpose of the gospel. I believe that's the key to understanding Romans chapter 7 and chapter 8. That passage where Paul is saying, the good I want to do, I can't do, and the bad I don't want to do, I end up doing. There's this tortured man trying to live a righteous life, but time and time again, he fails. I don't believe that this passage is talking about Paul as a Christian. I believe he's talking about his life before he was a Christian. And then Romans 8, it's like, thank God for Christ. There is no condemnation. And there's this sense that because of Christ, I can live the life that was previously cut off from me because of my own striving for achievement. Whether you give your best or your worst, it doesn't change your salvation, praise God. But it will affect your satisfaction and your legacy, whether your best and worst is built upon Jesus Christ or your own achievement. Number four, the fourth shift is this. I will worship God needs to shift to I am worshiping God. Yeah, I will pray. This is going to be a year of prayer. This is going to be a year of worship. This is going to be a year of change priorities. Verse 23. Now then, said Joshua, throw away the foreign gods that are among you and yield your hearts to the Lord. You see, the children of Israel are saying, we are not going to turn away. We are going to forsake the other gods. We are going to worship the God of Israel. How could we turn away? How could you question us, Joshua? But even as they were saying that, in their homes, they had appropriated idols from the nations that they had overtaken. They had already started forsaking the God of Israel. They had already started to compromise their faith. I want to ask you a question. Can you think of something that was once really easy to give up or change in your life that's now really hard? What might God be encouraging us to give up so we can worship Him fully? I love it. Joshua says, throw away the foreign gods that are among you and yield your hearts to the Lord. It's both. It's saying, I'm going to throw away the things that are distracting me. I'm going to throw away the attitudes. I'm going to throw away the technological devices. I'm going to throw away the addictions. I'm going to throw away that habit. I'm going to throw that away so that I can open myself and yield my heart to the Lord. Because at the end of the day, God is not after just our behavior. He's after our heart. And once He's got our heart, He can change everything about us. What's the thing that would have been easy to give up, but now it's really hard? Think about that substance abuse. Think about that food addiction. Think about that Facebook addiction. Think about the thing that's really hard to give up now, that if you'd been asked 5 years ago, you'd be like, yeah, easy, really easy. I wonder, not today, if God wants you to leave here with a to-do list, maybe today, it's not just saying, I will worship you, God, but no, I am worshiping you, God, and I am casting off the things that will hold me back. And the final point is this. We need to shift from being shaped by our experiences to being shaped by loving conviction. Verse 25, on that day, Joshua made a covenant. He cut in a covenant for the people, and there at Shechem, he reaffirmed to them the decrees and laws. I love the fact Joshua basically has told the people, you will fail. God's told me you are going to turn away from Him. And Joshua wasn't a false prophet. He spoke the truth. They turned away from God. They failed to live up to their promise to faithfully serve Him and forsake the gods of the nations around. But then the next step for Joshua is to say, I'm going to cut a covenant that is between God and the people. And the covenant is God's promise of faithfulness and love for the people. God is a God that even when we can't fulfill our side of the bargain, He says, I am committing to my people. I am the God of my people. These are my children and I love them. And He reaffirmed His commitment to the people. And then out of that covenantal commitment came laws for the people to follow, because ultimately the laws of God reflect what it means to have a healthy relationship with God. The law of God doesn't give us relationship with God, but the law of God shows us what it means to live in fidelity with the character of God because of His great love. I wonder, if you're just shaped by the experiences of your parents had a miracle one day and that's why you're in church, that's not going to keep you on fire for God. You had an experience of God when you were a teenager? Well, good luck, but that's not enough. I believe that God wants to build your life, not just on your experiences, and a lived experience of the Holy Spirit is really important, but it's got to be more than that. You see, Jesus, when He rose from the dead, He was walking down a road with two of His disciples, and they were grieving and they were mourning the fact that Jesus had died. And Jesus, rather than reveal Himself straight away and say, hey, I'm back, I'm risen from the dead, wake up, you drongos. He didn't say that. I don't think He knew what the word drongo meant back then. He was walking down the road to Emmaus. You read this at the end of Luke's gospel. And He had a Bible study with the disciples. And He explained to them from Moses and the prophets, basically the whole of the Old Testament, how they all were part of a bigger story of Jesus, the Son of God, restoring the people of God. And not just restoring the people of God, but restoring the whole world. You see, Jesus wanted their faith to be built upon not just their experience of him risen, but also the truth of the word of God, so that their life would be built upon the foundation of the scriptures and their experience of the risen Christ. I wonder today if you need to build your life, just like Joshua, he was encouraging the people of God to build their life on the covenant of God, but also the laws and decrees of God. What biblical convictions need to shape your life as opposed to your experiences? I wonder if some of us need to readdress the fact that we have a season of singleness or a gift of singleness that is to be embraced and not rejected. Is that a biblical conviction of our life, or are we kicking and screaming our current situation? I wonder if some of us have a biblical conviction over the danger of drunkenness towards ourselves and our families and the people around us. I wonder if some of us have biblical convictions about the importance of worship and fellowship with God's people. I wonder what biblical convictions God wants you to make advanced decisions about and saying, I will choose to serve the Lord and I will choose to build my life upon Jesus Christ and his word, so that no matter what circumstances come my way, I have already decided, as for me and my house, we will serve the Lord. At the heart of all this, what I love about faith, particularly for us as Christians, not like Joshua back in those days, but for us as Christians, it's to come back to God, it's really about coming home. It's recognizing that we don't have to take all this land and appropriate these victories because Jesus has already won the victory. Timothy Keller says that religious people find God useful, whereas Christians find God beautiful. And today, I want to encourage you, wherever you're at, to come home to your first love. To say, I'm not just going to talk about worshiping you, I'm actually going to worship you, God. I'm not just going to say I love you, but I'm going to bow in awe and reverence. And I want to serve you because I love you. I don't want to just have confidence in my own ability to achieve things. I want to have confidence in your goodness in spite of my weakness. I want to be shaped by convictions and not just by my experiences. Can we stand to our feet?